Yes, we are ready.
Perfect. So I just saw Nino connecting. So that's perfect. And we will do today the neuroleptic or antipsychotic drugs. So neuroleptic means which takes the nerve. And now, nowadays we use the term of antipsychotic drugs, and even more, we won't normally, we should not use the term of antipsychotic because the International Union on Pharmacology indicated that it was no longer clear in the denomination of this kind of drugs that it was antipsychotic, antidepressant, anxiolytic, etc. And the correct denomination should be correcting drugs for monoamines, which means nothing. But think about a patient. So if you are a physician and you see a patient with a sort of psychosis, and the psychosis can be due to several things. Disease can be bipolar mania, it can be schizophrenia. So psychosis does not mean necessarily schizophrenia. And you have also some kind of psychotic episodes with depression. So nothing is really clear. And the point is, the physician, when he gives a drug, he says, okay, I will give you an antipsychotic. And of course, the patient thinks, okay, I have schizophrenia, which is not necessarily the case. So the International Union of Pharmacology took some distance with the denomination of antipsychotic, antidepressant, anxiolytic, and nowadays try to impose a new terminology for these drugs, so correcting dopamine or correcting serotonin or correcting whatever. And you see that this is complicated because we have to explain this to medical staff and they don't really understand. Anyway, we are trying to progress. So, neuroleptic, antipsychotic, and in 10 years you will hear about correcting drugs for monoamines, correcting drugs for GABA, for some anxiolytic, etc., etc. So you have to understand that this is not easy because we are running after the efficacy of drugs. And you will see on this cartoon, globally this is a patient who think he is a Superman, so kind of schizophrenia, a good psychosis, and this is a story of the discovery of antipsychotic drugs, with the first one being chlorpromazine. And in the beginning, chlorpromazine was not used as an antipsychotic. It was used to calm down the patient before general anesthesia, which in 1950 and before was something dramatic because people could die from anesthesia. And even in your practice, if you will do behavior in rodents, if you need to anesthetize the animals, it is better that the animal is quiet, not stressed. And to know that you are going to a general anesthesia, at that time it was dramatic. Even now, but nowadays the anesthetics are better. The condition of anesthesia are better. So the physician tell you that please don't eat before, of course, because if you eat before an anesthesia, the adipose tissue increase and take the anesthetic drug and then release it in a curious way. So that's the reason why there was sometimes some abnormal release of anesthetic drugs and death. So it was extremely complicated at that time, and to avoid stress, French surgeon thought about a pill to reduce stress. So, to reduce stress, and some drugs are known to reduce stress or to calm down or to take some distance with the world, and those drugs are, for instance, antihistaminic drugs. So this is a side effect of these drugs, but it is their property. And so there was a new one, chlorpromazine, and Dr. Labori thought about using chlorpromazine. And it worked really well, so that the patient did not care about the world, and so he was starting to use this before anesthesia, and then he had another idea. So it is spectacular, and maybe we could use it in the treatment of agitation, of some cases in psychiatry where people are agitated. And of course, schizophrenia, for instance. And at that time, no treatments were available. People were closed in specific rooms, and more than that, it was difficult to imagine that this kind of disease could be related to imbalance of neurotransmission in the brain. It was magic. I mean, something that we don't understand, and it was difficult to imagine that we could act by chemistry against this kind of disease. So we knew that we could use, for instance, benzodiazepine, so to limit and to calm the patients. The problem of these drugs is that you have a huge tolerance. So after some pills, days or weeks of treatment, the efficacy was no longer present. So it was not a treatment. And then they tried to say that chlorpromazine could be interesting. And they tried, so the surgeons tried several psychiatrists most of them said, this is silly, impossible. And one of them, Professor Deniker in Paris, said, okay, we will try on some patients. So instead of a lot of things that were quite difficult for patients, when we think about it, and also violence, they try chlorpromazine and it works like a miracle. I mean, on 12 patients, I think, most of them had reduced hallucination after some time, and the delirium was also reduced. So, she said, because she's some sort of journalist, by reference to the story of Superman, it would be the treatment of schizophrenia, it would be like aspirin. So we could have some drugs acting on the disease and reducing the effect, the core effect of the disease, so hallucination, delirium, and agitation. Miracle. So it means that because it works, the brain the way we are understanding the disease is changing. And this is no longer something we don't understand, psychological things or something like that. It might be something going wrong in the brain that we could with drugs. This is biological psych. For that, it was psychology and straight jacket. From this very beginning, I don't know if you can imagine what it means, but it means a lot. Well, the problem is that it worked fine, but there are huge side effects, and this is the beginning of the use of these drugs, so a total discovery. And the questions are, what is behind the efficacy of chlorpromazine? What is behind the side effects induced of chlorpromazine? And honestly, in 1950, it was impossible to understand. But the good point is that some people could, after some time, get out the institution, the psychiatric hospital, and experience quite a normal life. I mean, normal life. Nowadays, you have to follow regularly psychologists, the psychiatrist, to see if everything is good. So you have various degree of schizophrenia. We say also that you have one schizophrenic patient, this is one schizophrenia, which means that there is a huge degree of variety between the different patients. But at the end, these people could somehow touch the hope to get out the institution and have a social life. This is important. So you see, nice to meet you, I'm Clark, Clark Kent, so, and Floyd something, so this is Superman, Superman. So, here is the context, here is the context of the antipsychotic. We are running after a serendipitous finding. And does it mean that the schizophrenia could be treated with antihistaminic compounds? Hey. So, chlorpromazine, the first neuroleptic, so which takes the nerve, and you see three cycle in this molecule. So this is like imipramine, which will be the origin and found almost at the same time, three cycle, but imipramine will give the will be the origin of antidepressant drugs. Here you have three cycles, chlorpromazine, which will give antipsychotic drugs. So there is a definition of these antipsychotic drugs, these neuroleptics, given in 1957. A neuroleptic is a drug characterized by psychomotor indifference. They no longer care about the world. That's it, psychomotor indifference. Efficacy against agitation. Progressive reduction of psychotropic troubles, so acute, chronic. In the very definition, you have also production of extrapyramidal and vegetative symptoms. So you know that if you take a neuroleptic, if it works, you should have extrapyramidal side effects, which are dystonia, it can be malignant syndrome consequent to neuroleptics and affecting the control of motor behavior. It can be acute dyskinesia. It can be reduction of locomotor activity, rigidity, like Parkinsonism, and the worst, it was also in this effect the tardive dyskinesia. And vegetative symptoms essentially associated with the production of prolactin. And these drugs are characterized by the fact that the subcortical effects are these are called the typical neuroleptics, and we will see why they are called typical. So now we will try first to understand their mechanism of action. Antihistaminic drugs, it was clear, because some blocking action of or the blockade of histamine receptor was not directly involved in the efficacy of antipsychotic drugs. And then people were swimming. What is behind the efficacy of neuroleptics? The first of the first hypothesis of schizophrenia was serotonin in something 59. So we are around here. 1959. Why serotonin? This is quite stupid, because it was determined that LSD, the hallucinogenic drug, LSD was binding on serotonin receptors. Okay? LSD induced psychomimetic effect, so it was thought that knowing the mechanism of action of LSD could give some clues the systems involved in schizophrenia. And so beyond the simple action of LSD on serotonin receptors, found in something like 1957 or something like that, that receptors were present in the brain. Then, okay, LSD is acting on serotonin receptors present in the brain, so by analogy with schizophrenia, it is possible that serotonin system and receptors are involved in the manifestation in schizophrenia. But it was far from to be clear. At least it was the first hypothesis. And into the scene, a new neurotransmitter system, dopamine. Neurotransmitter, beyond its being a precursor of noradrenaline, because before 1957, dopamine was the precursor of noradrenaline. Dot at line. It was not a system. So you see, in 1952, when you had the efficacy of chlorpromazine, it was impossible to think it was not existing. The determination of in 1957 and then characterized by Carlson around 1960, in parallel, people found in Parkinson's disease that Parkinson's disease was associated with a decrease, a dramatic decrease in dopamine in the striatum. So means that if you don't have dopamine, you develop rigidity, etc. Like if you inject neuroleptic, the effect. And so Carlson had the idea that maybe the efficacy of neuroleptic could be somehow. He did some experiment showing that antipsychotic mimic Parkinsonism in rodents, and it was more complicated because at that antipsychotic drugs you increase the activity of dopaminergic neurons. I mean, in terms of biochemistry, he was measuring dopamine in the tissue. You have an increase. But if you look at the course on monoamines, at the end, I explain that indeed, if you use a psychotic drug, you increase the activity of dopaminergic neurons. And in fact, you increase dopamine synthesis, etc., simply because you block receptors, so you block probably a sort of autocontrols, inhibitory autocontrols, and Carlson is probably one of the first proposing the existence of autoreceptors. Or something like auto-inhibitory control. It was data were accumulating, and Snyder proposed by taking everything, especially also the effect of L-DOPA in Parkinson's disease, so it was working, but physicians, psychiatrists were also given L-DOPA, this miracle pill for Parkinson's disease, in schizophrenic patients. So why not? And it was enhancing delirium and psychosis. So if we increase dopamine over the psychosis, and if we block dopamine, we limit psychosis. If we, for a long period, we develop paranoid psychosis, so like in schizophrenia, so all the arguments were in favor of the involvement, at least, of dopamine system in the efficacy of antipsychotic drugs, and maybe the involvement of dopamine in the etiology of schizophrenia. So I recall here on this slide the existence of dopamine terminals and for dopamine, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, and D2 as dopamine autoreceptors. In 1976, Simon looked at the pharmacological profile of a lot of distinct antipsychotic drugs. So we are 26 years later after the first use of chlorpromazine. So you have many drugs, and this cartoon, in fact, is not from 1976. It has been modified. So this is a new one. I think it is from 2000 or something like that. And this is remarkable. They plot here the concentration needed to occupy 25% of D2 receptors, and this is so think that it is similar to the affinity, but in that case this is 25%. 25%. Why 75? Because we know that at 75% occupancy for all antipsychotic drugs, psychotic efficacy. And we will see that, in fact, the threshold is something like 60%. So you can go to 100% with very high dose, but if you go to, you are sure to develop side effects. So 75% is a good for antipsychotic on D2 receptors. And then they took the free concentration of the epileptics here. So for instance, perphenazine, cisflupentixol, haloperidol. So basically it means that cisflupentixol, haloperidol, etc. have very high affinity for dopamine D2 receptors, while drugs like clozapine have very low affinity for dopamine D2 receptors. And then in patients, the free concentration of neuroleptic after in plasma or in order to determine whether we have a relation between the percentage occupancy, the free, this relationship, this is wonderful. It is clear. One, antipsychotic drugs needs to occupy D2 receptors, and this is dependent on its free concentration in plasma. So which means pharmacokinetic purpose apart, it means that if you take haloperidol, you will need few haloperidol. Why? Because you need a low concentration in plasma to reach percent occupancy. Why? If you take clozapine, you will take grams of clozapine, but the finality, the end point is the same. You will block of D2 receptors. So this is a perfect match between the receptors and the regimen you are given to the patients. Well, the problem is the side effects. If you look at the pharmacological profile of chlorpromazine, several other antipsychotic drugs, they act on H1 receptor, alpha-1 receptor, MD2 receptor. I mean, at least. Because you have also other targets. But this is a real concern. Wait and induce sleep. That was the very first purpose of using chlorpromazine. By Dr. Laborie. So they will be sleepy before anesthesia. Through alpha-1, it induces dizziness and hypotension. Through M1 blockade, but there is also other muscarinic concern, but through M1 concern, you can have dry mouth, visual troubles, and constipation, which needs other medication medication to avoid intestinal occlusion. And then you have the action on the at the origin of the efficacy of antipsychotic. So maybe we can conceive drug acting solely on the two receptors. What do you mean? What do you believe? No? And it would be involved in the reduction of psychosis. But this is not that simple. Why? Because take the course on monoamines and you will see that the ascending dopaminergic pathways are quite numerous. So this once here, but I can tell you that if I take part of the cortex or part of the amygdala, for instance, or part of the and several regions in the brain, I can measure a little bit of dopamine, which is not always related to noradrenergic terminals. Dopamine and dopamine receptors also in several parts of the brain. But here, simply looking at this, you have four main pathways: the nigrus striatal, mesoaccumbens, number two, mesocortical, number three, which by the way is not that developed, but anyway, and the tuberoinfundibular pathway, just here, from the hypothalamus to the pituitary gland, or systems. In all these systems, you have dopamine, two receptors. Thus, the consequence is that if you give a D2 antagonist, D2 receptors in all this pathway. This is a problem of pharmacology. You have the target everywhere, but you are interested only by one location. And this is difficult. And the consequence, we think, at least that one main consequence, is, for instance, the chronic blockade of dopamine nigrus striatal pathway induce the extrapyramidal side effects, including dystonia and dyskinesia. So on the very right part of the slide, so this is a GIF animation showing abnormal movement of lung. Here, I don't remember, neck, jaw, and this is recurrent, running abnormal effect, and without treatment. We think that the amelioration of the positive symptoms in schizophrenia is blockade of dopamine receptor in the accumbal system, which would be the amelioration symptoms. We think that the aggravation of the negative symptoms, which are related to poor thinking, social isolation, and I mean that's already a lot, would be related to the blockade of dopamine receptors in the cortex. So aggravation of negative symptoms. And quite clearer, we think that the vegetative effects, including the increased secretion of prolactin, would be related to an effect in the gland. And then there is an actor also, this cartoon is in French and quite... We have another concern, which is the cognitive dimension of schizophrenia. But again, the cognitive dimension of schizophrenia would be related somehow with dopamine and dopamine receptors. So if you are blocking dopamine receptors in prefrontal cortex or cingulate cortex, you might act against amelioration of cognitive defect in schizophrenia. So the question, because it works, and I can tell you it works quite well. But the question is, can we ameliorate the drugs by conserving drugs acting specifically or more specifically in the mesoaccumbens dopaminergic pathway? That's the question. And honestly, I think it is quite impossible. But I'm wrong and stupid. Now, yes. The point is, this is a posteriori. The point is, we can think about it with another sort of drugs. Another drugs which are antipsychotics, but these drugs have no extrapyramidal side effects, no hyperprolactinemia. They improve both the positive and the negative symptoms of schizophrenia, and they are more efficacious because they can rescue some schizophrenia that were resistant to typical neuroleptics. So, and this pattern of efficacy was obtained with one neuroleptic, which was clozapine. So clozapine, you see, has been discovered in 1959. It in clinic after its characterization from... So, can you cut your microphone and your
Okay, doctor, it was by mistake.
Okay, and the camera also.
I
think you don't need it.
Okay.
Otherwise, we will see your children. Okay, thank you. So, it has been used in clinic in 1969 to 1975, but there was a main problem. The main problem was that it induced agranulocytosis, means that it decreased blood cells dramatically. death. So, what do we do? It is probably one of the antipsychotic ever, and we cannot use it. So it went back in the clinic in 1989, but specifically in the clinic and with specific guidelines to use it with a measurement of blood cells every, I think it is 3 days or something like that, in order to respond fast in case of dramatic decrease of blood cells. So you understand this is difficult to manage. Depending on the disease and the region in the world, probably the way it is administered, etc., you can expect something like 1 to 4%. I mean, it's what I saw. 1 to 4% of patients treated with clozapine who would develop agranulocytosis. And concern, you have also some other side effects, but minimal compared to this one. So clozapine can be used, but you understand that because of clozapine, the context of antipsychotic completely changed, because based on the initial definition of neuroleptics, then we have to get a new one, and a new one starts by the denomination of these drugs, which are now called atypical antipsychotics, because their effect is not like neuroleptics. You understand? And they clearly have some sort of superiority compared to neuroleptics. Don't say neuroleptics are shitty drugs. They are very good drugs. But the side effects, especially those long, administration, for instance 1 year, 2 years, etc., etc., is difficult to manage. Okay, and the patient. So there are some other atypical antipsychotics. I mean, mother, the parent compound of several new drugs. And several of these drugs, which are presented here, have been developed based on the pharmacological profile. I mean, based on the idea that we had behind the and superiority of clozapine in the treatment of schizophrenia. Because you will see clozapine is matter of pharmacological profile. But based on its pharmacological profile, some people went back to the idea that maybe if clozapine is more efficacious than neuroleptics, I mean in terms of extrapyramidal side effects, it is because clozapine can block with more serotonin receptors compared to dopamine receptors, even if dopamine receptor need to be blocked. And somehow we go back on the serotonin hypothesis of schizophrenia, another angle. So you have clozapine, risperidone, olanzapine, quetiapine, sertindol, ziprasidone, and zotepine. I think several of them have been sertindol, ziprasidone, zotepine. No, I think they went to clinic also. But when you have, in parenthesis, another name, this is one name, I mean in Europe, I think, of the... this is the name of the on the box that you can buy in pharmacy. I have to say also that clozapine among them is perhaps drug. I mean, the other one are also efficacious, but in case of olanzapine, and I think also ziprasidone, and in case of risperidone, there might be depending on the dose, some extrapyramidal side effects. But they are lower compared to haloperidol or chlorpromazine. And it is not rare that risperidone is used as a classical atypical antipsychotic in clinical studies. So, let's